You ever take a look at your own code and think to yourself, what was I thinking? That's exactly what I thought looking at my old entity component system. At first, it seemed okay. It did what I needed it to do and it followed my set of rules I created for this project. But as I kept working on it, the cracks started to show. Let's take a look at this example code. It might look okay, but there's a function specifically called addTransformComponent. Every component I wanted to use needed its own specific functions for adding, removing, and managing. That's a lot of repetitive code. And it didn't stop there. There's so many things to manage. A mapper struct and the transform component is actually all of the transform components combined. With all this boilerplate and complexity, just to make something work, it wasn't fun. Now, let me show you how the same thing works in my new entity component system. First, notice how now we've streamlined everything. Instead of mapper, we only have component store. It stores both the components themselves and their relations to entities. And here's the best part. Adding a component is now dynamic. This one function can take any component and add it to the component store. No extra boilerplate needed. The big difference is that now the transform component struct holds just one transform component. It's much easier to work with. But how did we even get there? It wasn't as simple as flipping a switch. This video is all about the messy, frustrating, and ultimately rewarding process of building this new ECS. Showing my pitfalls, why and how I had to break my own rules, and lessons learned along the way. In the beginning, I had a set of rules. I thought it would be fun to give me limitations, because making a game engine from scratch isn't hard enough already. The main rule was to try and use struct of arrays. If you're not familiar, here's the idea. Instead of struct having properties like position, rotation, and scale, you split those into separate arrays. CPUs love organized memory like this, since arrays are neatly packed together. Let's take a look at an example. In our SOA, the same index across all the arrays represents the same object. So, for instance, in our transform component, the index 2 in these arrays would point to the same cube. It sounds really good, but it's so hard to work with, and I'm not good enough developer yet to build the infrastructure to support something like this. That's where all this mess came from. To make the SOAs work, I had handwritten everything. Every single component had its own custom function for adding, removing, and managing. After weeks and weeks, I had to face the truth. I wasn't making a game engine. I was just writing useless boilerplate. Which is why I decided to change the way I handle components. Still stuck in my own rules, I was desperately looking for a way to make the process simpler. That's when I remembered that C++ has templates. Templates are like a flexible blueprint for code. Here's a quick example. Let's say we have a function that adds two numbers together. This function works with ints, but what about floats? We don't want to rewrite the function, so we turn it into a template. By adding a generic parameter t, we can call the function with any type that can be added together. Naturally, I thought, this is it. This will save me from writing a bunch of useless code. The plan seemed simple. Create a set of templates that manage the components, their creation, updates, and connection to entities. But SOAs didn't want to play nice, not even with templates. I had to create some way to unwrap these arrays and treat each index as an instance so that I could work with the components individually. So I created a template for component traits. Basically, just take the arrays and make them not arrays. And then I had this idea. I wanted to take an instance out of the array, modify it, and have the data update the array itself. That's what references are for, right? Sure, but they're not easy to work with as well. And suddenly, I was writing even worse boilerplate than before. Nothing was simpler. In fact, everything was even harder to do. So, in my madness, I decided to break my rules. After throwing out everything I've built so far, I went on a quest. I started diving into popular ECS libraries, trying to figure out how they're built. The libraries were polished, well-written, and often beyond my skill level. But they all had many different approaches to the whole ECS concept. So, I decided to make a new plan. I wanted to keep the ECS simple. Entities, components, some sort of mapping, and mainly a good component querying system. Entities don't change. They're just IDs. There isn't much I can do about them. The big change was in how I manage components. Components are now simple structs, with thick layer of templates for managing any kind of component, and a component store to store it all. Do we lose some of the juicy SOA performance? Probably. Do we gain our sanity back? Definitely. Now, let's talk about querying components. I already had a simple querying system in the previous version, but this time I've decided to go all out. The way it works is very simple. We have a query type, which is a template that can have multiple different types assigned to it. These are the types I want to look for in the component store. When I call getQuery, it scans the component store and gives me this object back, with entity IDs that have all the components I requested. Why return the object? This way, I can save the result and I don't have to query the components every frame, which would probably kill the frame rate. Here's an example. Rendering data. Imagine you're rendering a scene, and the player isn't even moving around. Maybe you don't want to query all the renderable components each frame in that case. With the query object, we can just save the results and reuse them. And this is my favorite part. When we loop through the results of the query, we get instances of the components as references, directly from their arrays. That means I can modify them and the changes are reflected directly in the component store. Finally, this code makes me happy. It's much cleaner, simpler, and most importantly, usable. Is it perfect? Of course not, but no code ever is. This is my first time building something like this, an entire game engine. And if you've seen any of the previous videos, you know that this is far from what I had before. But that's the point. I'm allowing the engine to evolve freely and letting myself to evolve along with it. At the end of the day, that's what it's all about. Growing, enjoying the process, and evolving alongside my project. And this ECS is something I enjoy working with. Thank you for watching. If you enjoyed this, subscribe, stick around, and come along for the ride. There's plenty more to build and plenty more to learn.